Hi guys, welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and today we're going to talk about the medieval hunt as it relates to warfare in the Middle Ages. Hey guys, welcome back. So before we get started, there will be links in the description to Pinterest albums of a lot of the images that I'll be using today, as well as a link to an excellent article that if you find this subject interesting, you really want to read, because it goes a lot further in depth than some of the things that I'm gonna talk about today. So if you find this interesting, I highly recommend that you read this article. So hunting in the Middle Ages was an incredibly popular activity, and it wasn't just viewed as an exciting sport or a means to gain food. It was actually viewed as one of the best means of training for warfare. And it was particularly popular amongst the upper classes, so the knightly class, the gentlemanly man-at-arms. How do we know about medieval hunting? Well, very analogous to the way that we know about medieval fighting techniques, through the survival of late medieval and Renaissance fighting treatises, we have surviving hunting manuals from this basically the same time period. The most famous of these hunting manuals is the hunting manual Le Livre de la Chasse, or the Book of the Hunt, written by Gaston Phoebus. Now, Gaston Phoebus was Gaston III, the Count of Foix in late 14th century France, and he, based on what we know about him, hunting was one of his absolute passions, but he wasn't just a hunter, he was also a military leader. In fact, he amassed his fortune by ransoming his chief rivals in a victory that he won in battle. But through his Book of the Hunt, we have an incredible wealth of information about how the medieval hunt was done. The book was considered so important at the time that it was actually copied over 40 times from the late 14th century through to the 16th century. Several of those copies are beautifully illuminated as well, so very detailed illuminations, very detailed illustrations on all the different aspects you could ever wonder about the medieval hunt. Another very famous hunting manual is The Master of Game by Edward of Norwich, which is actually the first English translation of Gaston Phoebus's work done at the turn of the 14th, 15th century, early 15th century, with additional information given by Edward of Norwich himself. And again, not only was hunting one of his passions, but he wasn't just a hunter exclusively, he was a military leader. In fact, he died at the Battle of Agincourt in 1415, and he was the nephew of the Black Prince and John of Gaunt, grandson of Edward III, the King of England. So earlier this year, my Living History group wanted to do a demonstration of the medieval hunting camp as inspired by the works of Gaston Phoebus. And we were able to pull this off with the help of the gentleman from St. Hubert's Rangers, who are actually the authors of the article that I linked in the description below. And they actually do this for real. And when I say for real, I don't mean that they reenact medieval hunting. I mean that they actually do it. So they put on actual medieval kit, use medieval weapons, and hunt real, live, dangerous game using the techniques that we have learned through medieval hunting manuals, through the surviving medieval hunting manuals. So if you'd like to learn more about their experiences, look up St. Hubert's Rangers. They are an incredible wealth of knowledge, because you can't possibly understand this stuff as well from just reading about it than actually doing it. So these guys have real firsthand experience of what it's like to do what it says in these hunting manuals. So our presentation earlier this year obviously included the visual material culture aspect of the medieval hunting camp. So we wanted to show the tools of the medieval hunt, things like spears, swords, also the techniques of the medieval hunt. This image here is of what's called a stalking horse. It's basically a stuffed dummy horse that won't spook game, that allows a hunter to wait behind it for game to be flushed by and then shoot them. One other thing to understand is that the medieval hunt was kind of a grand social affair too. So the in the illuminated manuscripts, we see a very obvious delineation between the upper class and the huntsmen. So the gentlemanly hunters are always depicted wearing these kind of grand gowns with brocades and actually using them during the hunt on horseback, as opposed to the more plainly dressed huntsmen that are working with them. But more importantly, what we wanted to show was how this kind of leads into hunting's relationship with medieval warfare. So everybody kind of keys in on the weapons when they think about how does hunting relate to warfare. And that's kind of the obvious one. Obviously, the weapons, in fact, the weapons used on the medieval battlefield are not all that different from the weapons used in the hunt. In the hunt, you're hunting with swords, you're hunting with spears, you're hunting with bows, crossbows, and longbows. So these are the same tools that are going to be utilized on the battlefield. So getting that real life practice, learning how to use that weapon for real life against a real opponent, when you know you can't stab your friend in fencing practice, you can do that in actual hunting. Now, the more gruesome side of that is learning and conditioning yourself to the effects that those weapons are going to have. A lot of modern HEMA, historical European martial arts practitioners, try to get insight into what the weapon is capable of by using swords and things like that against sides of beef and pig carcasses and things like that. But there's a certain artificial aspect to that that just can't translate to doing this for real life against a living, breathing opponent that pumps blood through its veins, that's gonna come out when you stab it, and getting used to being able to see that kind of thing, inflicting those kind of wounds, and keeping yourself composed and keeping yourself safe as you can while that, not only are you inflicting wounds on something, but that same thing is trying to kill you for real. These are things that you just can't simulate in an artificial training environment. Less tangible than that, though, are other aspects of warfare that really just don't come through in something like a fencing school. King Alfonso XI of Castile in the first half of the 14th century had this to say: "For a knight should always engage in anything to do with arms and chivalry, and if he cannot do so in war, he should do so in activities which resemble war, and the chase is the most similar to war for these reasons. War demands expense met without complaint. One must be well horsed and well armed. One must be vigorous and do without sleep, suffer lack of good food and drink, rise early, sometimes have a poor bed, undergo cold and heat, and conceal one's fear." What is he talking about there? You know, he's not talking about specific weapons use. He's talking about dealing with being on campaign, dealing with having to, you know, sacrifice comfort. You're going to be uncomfortable in the field. You're going to need to learn to deal with having to carry a weapon for a long period of time over difficult terrain. How to maneuver in that terrain, how to coordinate with other people, the other hunters, how to communicate with them and do coordinated movements over rough and unprepared terrain, learning how to sleep in the field, learning how to go without food, learning how to go with a lack of sleep when you're tired. He's talking about things that just don't come across in normal martial arts training. The weather. You know, in the military, you hear that saying, if it's not raining, you're not training. Weather is not cooperative in real warfare. Learning how to coordinate movements in the rain and crappy weather is very different and far more uncomfortable than it is doing these things in good weather. And like I said, you cannot control the weather in real warfare. Just ask the French at Agincourt. But one of the last things he talks about is learning to conceal and control one's fear. In the modern HEMA world, and even in the Middle Ages, learning to fence against a friendly opponent, you know, it's very difficult to simulate the fear that you would have of your opponent, of your opponent's weapon, and that feeling you get when someone is really trying to kill you. The boar is not pretending. He is trying to kill you. The bear wants to kill you. Even people don't necessarily think of deer as something to be afraid of if they're not familiar with them, but the red deer of medieval Europe, the stag or the hart, this is an animal the size of a modern North American elk, if not a little bit bigger, and it will kill you. So approaching it with a spear or sword in hand to try to kill something that is intent on survival and will and can kill you back, learning to remain composed in that environment and learning to do what you need to in order to survive in that environment, no other activity can teach you that kind of intangible other than doing it for real in warfare. So as modern practitioners, modern reenactors, modern HEMA practitioners, people kind of have that debate constantly about whether or not the sporting side of HEMA, the tournament, things like that, are getting too far away from the martial art aspect. The actual idea that this was a martial art used to fight and kill other people. We kind of think of that as a byproduct of the modern revival of historical European martial arts, because we are safe in the knowledge that we're never going to have to employ the pole axe or the spear or the sword in real warfare against an opposing army with similar training. So we kind of make the mistake of thinking that this is a new argument. However, this critique is not new. King John I of Portugal in the turn of the 14th, 15th century said, "For hunting is a training for all types of fighting men within war, against a foe crossing in front, in a head-on encounter or in a pursuit, in an awkward situation or a sounder one. For every kind of military encounter, hunting is a better training than jousting. If the tourney teaches a man how to strike with a sword on a helmet, how much better he will learn by striking down a boar when his only chance of saving himself is by a good thrust with the spear." So he doesn't even leave it up to debate. He's pretty clear that his belief is not only is hunting an excellent training for warfare, it's the superior training to warfare when compared to things like tournament fighting, because of those intangibles, because of the realism, because all the things that you're trying to create a safe environment for in the tournament, all that goes out the window in hunting because it's the real deal. You're up against an opposing force that is trying to kill you. But what I hope you've learned from this is hunting is not only kind of a sporting activity, but it was an integral part of the training of a man-at-arms in the Middle Ages. So much so that I would say that familiarity with hunting amongst the knightly class was probably just as important as familiarity with learning to fence and learning to use those weapons in a more traditional martial arts environment. Hope you guys found that interesting. Links in the description below for a lot of the source information that I drew this from. If you have any questions, please leave those down below, and I always try to get to what I can. All social media links and things like that will be down below, and thank you very much to the people who have decided to help support the channel on Patreon. That's very much appreciated. Thank you, and hope to see you again in the next video. Bye.